Everybody take a breath. I know it's going to get a little deep. Like I said earlier, the Nephilim are not the sons of God. The angels who mated with the women bore offspring from that disastrous union. Certain angels actually organized a plot to inbreed with human women and swore an evil oath to seal the devastating conspiracy. This mirrors the exact description in Genesis. And it came to pass when the children of men had multiplied that in those days were born unto them beautiful and comely daughters. And the angels and children of heaven saw and lusted after them and said to one another, Come, let us choose us wives from among the children of men. When the flood killed the giants, their spirit separated from their bodies as spirit beings, whose sole purpose is to torture and devastate man until judgment day. These are the beings called demons or devils that Jesus encountered in his day. Now, I'm going to give you guys what the church view is. The church view is that the flood was caused by the corrupt actions of mankind. Now, I'm going to give you the Bible view. The Bible view is the flood was caused by the corrupt actions of the angels. The first 8 verses of the 6th chapter of Genesis describe an incredible series of events that, when taken in its entirety, leave a gaping hole in the church's view of mankind's past. The circumstance that caused Yahweh such regret is a master key to understanding many of the enigmas of the Bible, human history, and much of what is known in our world as the paranormal. The flood of Noah is perhaps the best known of the Old Testament Bible stories. Yet the cause of the worst catastrophe in human history is steeped in mystery. The relationship between the Nephilim, or the so-called giants, mighty men, men of renown, and the flood is not revealed from the pulpit. The relationship of the Nephilim to the devils of the New Testament is seldom considered. So you got to ask, why did Yahweh decide to destroy all life? Now, I put in here a passage, but I just read basically all of it to you. It says that this is Genesis 6:6, as it repented the Lord that he had made man on earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping thing and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Now that we've discussed the Nephilim, we should be left with a good understanding as to who they were. Now, if you know much about the Old Testament, you remember reading about the Anakim. Who were the Anakim of the Old Testament? Well, in the Torah, the Anakim are the descendants of Enoch and dwelt in the south of Canaan, in the neighborhood of Hebron. In the days of Abraham, they inhabited the region afterwards known as Edom or Moab, east of the Jordan River. They are mentioned during the report of the spies about the inhabitants of the land of Canaan. The book of Joshua states that Joshua finally expelled them from the land, excepting a remnant that found a refuge in the cities of Gaza, Gath, and Ashdod. The Philistine giant, Goliath, well-known giant, right, whom David or Elhanan later encountered, were supposedly descendants of the Anakim. The Sumerians called their gods the Anunnaki. Abraham, being the son of an idol manufacturer in the Sumerian city of Ur, could reasonably be expected to have known about these gods. If you go to Numbers 13:33, it reads, And there we saw the giants, the son of Enoch, which come of the giants, and we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. And then you go to Deuteronomy 1, verse 28, says, Whither shall we go up? Our brethren have discouraged our hearts, saying, The people is greater and taller than we. The cities are great and walled up to heaven. And moreover, we have seen the sons of the Anakim there. And then again, Deuteronomy 3:11. For only Og, king of Bashan, remained of the remnants of the giants. Behold, his bedstead was a bedstead of iron. It is not in Rabbath of the children of Ammon, 9 cubits was the length thereof, and 4 cubits the breadth of it after the cubit of man. You're funny, Rutkus. So where did the Anunnaki, or Anakim, go? Were they destroyed in the flood as well? Well, I'll get to that a little bit later. It seems, I don't know about you guys, it seems to me that there's a lot missing in what the church is teaching. I have to ask myself, why? Why isn't the church talking about this stuff? But yet we can see geologists digging up human remains of people that were in excess of 12 to 16 feet tall. I know that in Iraq they had found these axes that stood well above a 6 foot tall man. Who did they belong to? With only a few words from Moses and a brief general description from Matthew and Luke, there is a little to point to the true cause of man's evil binge before the flood. In Matthew 24:37, "But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the days that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came, and took them all away, so shall also the coming of man be." In Genesis 5:24, "And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him." And Paul recalls his favor with God in Hebrews 11:15. "By faith Enoch was translated, that he should not see death, and was not found, because God had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God." There's supposedly a book out there that they found that was left out of the Bible for Enoch. Why isn't his book in the Bible? The book of Enoch was recognized centuries before Christ. It was accepted by early Christians, and early Christian literature contains many references to it. The book was an accepted part of the scripture up to the middle of the 3rd century when the church leadership decided to ban it during the Council of Laodicea. Along with 40 other books, it was banned as a scriptural source and was lost for over 1,000 years. It wasn't until the late 1700s that a copy surfaced. Well, the obvious reason for this mass book banning was that these books did not agree with the beliefs of the church leaders. And here again, we have leaders in the pulpit teaching us what they want to teach us, not what God wants us to learn. During the same council, this leadership declared that keeping the Sabbath was a sin. The simple reality was Scripture did not determine what was accepted by society. Rather, society determined what Scripture was accepted. Kind of like today. This might have occurred centuries ago, but the modern-day churches practice the same contradictions today. There is a source that sheds considerable light on the cause of mankind's demise and presents a scenario so unorthodox, it is no wonder it was rejected by the church. If you guys get a chance, research this book. Where does this leave us today? I'm sure a little bit confused, and perhaps in a great position to be deceived. All right, let's take a look and see how this could be possible. All right, how is it possible we could be fooled? How is it possible that the church isn't teaching us the things that they should teach us so that we won't be deceived? And I thought about this today, too. Because of all of this, because of what I'm about to tell you, it's very easy to misunderstand what I'm saying. So it's really imperative that if you're interested in learning this, take it for what it is. Don't believe me. Do your own research. But this really hit me hard, and it's hit me hard with dreams and whatnot, and I've been moved to do this, so I'm just gonna get it out. All right? Okay, the causes behind UFO sightings, abductions, and other paranormal phenomena are more malignant and awful than any theory scientists have ever proposed. The tribulation or end times will officially begin when Israel signs a treaty with the head of the government of unified Europe to establish a Jewish temple in Jerusalem and resume the ancient sacrificial system of worship there. The man who signs this treaty for Israel will be unique. He will be believed by many to be the long-awaited Messiah.